tonight. God bless. Come on, praise team. Let's do this.
Y'all get ready. We're fixing to worship the Lord up here.
I count on one thing, the same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now. Same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes. Come see the scars of love upon his hands. The King is in the room. We'll watch the darkness flee at his command. Who is this King? Who is this King? His name.
Awesome and powerful. to go, but before I leave, go tell the world about me. For I was dead, but now I live. I gotta go now for a little while. The goodbye's not the end. Don't forget the things that I've taught you. I've conquered death and I hold the key.
Fixing to sing it the correct way.
We hope. We hope.
We hope.
Breathe the air of heaven where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets to look upon the one who led. Again.
day we join in resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith with one voice, a thousand generations. Seem worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of
give the Lord a hand clap of praise. Amen. Oh, I tell you what, church. We're going to close in prayer. Oh, hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but man. Yeah, amen. That, if that don't crank your tractor. Glory, glory, glory. While this thing's thinking about it. Oh, we got a brick to color in this morning. Amen. I don't know if y'all care anything about the bulletins and all that kind of stuff. Listen, folks, come on. Look at our congregation. Back in, what was it, 2004, when this thing, when we finally moved in it, $1.6 million. You're down to just over $46,000 now. Amen. 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 Never, ever, ever, not one time. Now, see, you pay your tithes, okay? That pays the bills, and that pays the ministries, and that does all this kind of stuff. Not one penny of that has ever paid a dime on this building. It's always been your offerings above the tithe. You have almost paid this building off. And it's just a show of God's faithfulness and God's providence when he's got people that hear and obey his voice. Amen. Give God the glory. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Man, I'm telling you. Don't know if y'all came to have church today or not, but I did. Oh, goodness gracious. Seems like there was something else. Where's that thing? There it is. All right. I'll wait about that. Don't want to embarrass anybody without asking their permission, so I'll wait about that. It is good to have Brother Bobby Pike with us here today. Amen. Amen. Miss Joan, we're still praying for her. She's still making progress as the days go by. So we're continuing to pray for Bobby and Joan, and we believe in God for some good things to take place. And also continue to pray for Carl Smith. I know some of you know him, some of you don't. They used to go to church here, but he's had two heart attacks in one day. And so he's been in bad shape, but he's doing better. And so he's still in ICU, or CVICU at East Alabama. So just continue to pray that God will do something wonderful there. And God is able. Amen? Amen. Amen. So, all right, last week we began a sermon series, God is Spirit. God is Spirit. So today we're going to do part two of God is Spirit. Last week we talked about the necessity of the Holy Spirit. We went back and we looked at creation. Creation would not have happened without the Holy Spirit. And we talked about the Trinity, the triune Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We went through all of that. So that was the necessity of the Holy Spirit. And we talked about a little bit about how Jesus told Nicodemus, you have to be born again. If you're going to go to heaven, you're not going to get to heaven because you do good works. There's a lot of people in this world just trying to do good works, good deeds. And they're hoping that when they die, that the scale tilts in their favor. That they've done more good than bad. I can tell you now, if you never done any bad works, which we know that's not possible, but if we've never done anything bad, it's still not enough to get us into the kingdom of God. We have to be born of God's Holy Spirit. So we're going to talk about the redemptive work of God's Holy Spirit today. Next week, we'll talk about the indwelling power of the Holy Spirit, and we'll conclude the series with that one. But today, let's talk about the redemptive work of God's Holy Spirit. So before we get into the scripture, let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, sir, we do thank you for this day. Thank you. Oh, Father, thank you. Thank you for the presence and the power of your Holy Spirit already, Lord, that we can sense. God, it's not something you... We're not looking for goosebumps or our hair to tingle or nothing. None of that. But God, when our souls are stirred by your Holy Spirit, Father, that's what we long for. That's what we need. As human beings, we need the touch of the Almighty God. And your Holy Spirit is that avenue in which you have chosen to use. So, Lord, help us today to kind of get our hearts and our minds wrapped around this idea of the work, the regenerative work of your Holy Spirit in our lives. And so, Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. Help us now to hear what the Spirit is saying to us, the church. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said amen and amen. We're going to go back to John chapter 4, verse number 23 and 24. We're going to look at that first. Jesus says, but the hour is coming, and now is, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. So let's talk about this for just a little while here this morning, the redemptive work of God's Holy Spirit. He says in verse number 23, we read it, that true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For one to be a true worshiper, our spirit, we talked about us last week, remember, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, he's three parts. We're also three parts. Paul tells us that we're body, soul, and spirit. In order for us to worship God and to know the truth, the Holy Spirit has to do a work with our spirit. Our spirit is simply this. It's our decision-making, our choice-choosing mechanism that God has given us. You see, when God created us, now because of what happened in Genesis chapter 3, when man chose, he made a choice to not believe God and to disobey God. Now everybody, say thank you, Adam. I hold him at fault. Yes, Eve took the fruit, but Adam was there and did not do what the man should have done. Should have protected his wife, and he didn't do it. And so now, because of that, when we're born, you don't have to teach us. I tell you, folks, watch children. Watch children. You catch a little child, just a young child, doing something that they shouldn't do. What are you doing? Nothing. Nothing. And you know that they know they shouldn't be doing it. You see, that's our nature. That's our spirit that is unregenerate, needs to be born again. We need to allow God's Holy Spirit to work in us to teach us how to get victory over this nature, this flesh. So, in order for that to take place, we have to understand that, and Psalm 51 says we are born in sin. Romans chapter 3 says there's none righteous, no, not one. Ephesians chapter 2 says we were far from God. All of those things, and man, there is just dozens and dozens of scriptures that talk about that. So we have to understand redemption is a must. It's not optional. If we're going to be saved, we have to be redeemed. Jesus said in verse 24, said those who worship him must worship in spirit and in truth. Now, worshipers, or those who worship, is talking about individuals that carry out this act of worshiping. So they have to, that's what we were made for. And it says, who are we worshiping? It says, we're worshiping the Father or Him. He is the object of our worship. Listen to me, folks. You're going to worship something. You're going to worship someone because God made us to worship. If it's not Him, then it is someone else or something else. Some people worship power. Some people worship money. Some people worship their ideals or ideas of a culture. And you see that stuff is constantly changing and shifting. And so we have to understand God is supposed to be the object of our worship if we're true worshipers. And then it also says, when you look at the word worship there, those who worship Him must worship in spirit and in truth. That's a verb. That is a command. That is an action. That is a call to action. It dictates, he says here, he says, those who worship Him, that's what we're called to do. If we're going to worship Him, we must worship in spirit and in truth. You see, let me say it this way. I'll never be complete until I'm doing what I was designed to do. You'll never be complete until you're doing what God designed you to do. He designed us to worship Him. I'm going to show you in Scripture. I'll never be satisfied until I'm in a right relationship with my Creator. You've heard it explained. I've heard it explained before. It's like there's a God hole in us, and only God can fill that hole. Listen, I see people, I've done it myself. You look to anything and everything else to fill you, to bring you joy, to bring you happiness, to bring you contentment, to bring you peace, and none of that works. You could go as far as you want to go, get as much money as you want. You just name it. You can get everything that you want and still be miserable. I'll never be satisfied until I'm in a right relationship with my Creator. I'll never have true joy until I know the source of my joy. You ever notice with Christians? And we've been there, folks. You broke. Mama's mad at you. Daddy's mad at you. The dog bit you. The cat won't let you rub them. I mean, and you just go right on down the road. You get fired. All these kind of things. But you still got a smile on your face. Why? Because you know where your true source of joy is. My joy, your joy, does not come from a bank account. Does not come from a job. Does not come from the approval of man. Our source of joy comes from the one who is brings joy in the morning. Hey, weeping endures for a night, endures for a little while, but joy comes in the morning because, hey, might have wept all night, might have prayed all night, might have cried all night, might have fasted all for a day and a week and a month, and all. But hey, I'm telling you, sooner or later, when I know that my Redeemer lives, joy is going to come my way. Amen. And you see, it says the Father is seeking. He's seeking such. He wants, He desires, He has made a way for us to be in that right relationship with Him. You see, in John 3:16, for God so loved that He gave. In Luke 19:10, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which is lost. He is desiring that. In 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That is God the Father seeking us. You hear so much about humanity in their search for God. Where are they going to find Him? Where are they going to find Him? When we come to the realization that God is seeking us, then we're making progress. We talked about in Tuesday's Word, the prodigal son. The prodigal son wasn't seeking his father. He knew where he was at. All he had to do was go home. And the Father was looking for him. And the Father is looking for us. He is looking not only for the people here, but He is looking for people out there, people who need a relationship with God and don't have it. He is seeking such to worship Him. You see, Isaiah 43:21 says, God is speaking here. He says, this people I formed for myself. He said, I made you. Jeremiah says it this way. He told Jeremiah, he said, I knit you together in your mother's womb. I can remember one day I was talking with someone who had an extremely low self-esteem, and I began to share scriptures how you are wonderfully and beautifully made, and how that God knit you together and He made you wonderfully, and all this kind of stuff. And they just began to weep and cry because they never realized that God made them. The Creator created them the way He wanted them to be. Just because humanity rejects us, that's not a mark against God. God made you the way He wanted you to be. Don't think that God makes junk because He doesn't. Never, never does God make a mistake, and never does God make junk. He says, this people I form for myself, and what is their purpose? They shall declare my praise. God made us for His purpose, and He made us to praise Him, to worship Him. So you can go out and you can find any job you want to find. And I'm not saying we can't be happy in our jobs. Man, I was happy as a door greeter back in whatever year it was that they invited me to be an usher. Man, I was tickled. I said, yes! I get to do something for God because I was in a place in my life where I felt rejected because I had sinned against God, but then I repented of my sin and I came to God and I just wanted to do something for God to just show my love and appreciation for Him. And Brother Jay Rogers came to me one day. He said, Brother Ricky, he said, will you be an usher? Man, I wept. I shouted. I was happy. Why? because I was getting to fulfill my purpose. God made me to worship, and I was glad to open the house, the door to the house of the Lord, and invite people to come in. Had a smile on my face because we get to worship God together. Amen to God. Man, that tickles me. That gets me going when I know I'm doing what I was created to do. He says the Father is seeking such. You see, God made humanity to be in a relationship with Him and worship Him. But He said, we have to worship in spirit. The flesh, my old nature, your old nature, we can't please God. The Bible tells us that this old nature, the carnal person, is not subject, is not obedient to God. Why do you think it's so hard to say yes to God? Because the flesh is saying, no, no, no. I don't want to give that up. I don't want to quit that. No. Because the flesh enjoys the pleasures of sin. And it's going to take God's Holy Spirit working with our spirit to break that chain, to break that bondage, to break that will and cause us to be obedient. We must worship in spirit. We are body, soul, and spirit. As Paul tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23, now may the God of peace himself sanctify you and me and us completely. It takes God, it takes his Holy Spirit to sanctify us. I can't do it myself. Let me speak to just the men. You ladies, y'all can diddle in your bulletin or something while I'm talking to the guys. Guys, y'all know how smart we are. Y'all know we know what we're doing. A lot of times we ain't even got to read the instructions. We just do it. We know. I can't tell you how many times I've put stuff together and had so many spare parts left over, I could have built another one. 2 for 1. Why? Because I didn't read the instructions. I was so smart. And you see, that's what God's got to deal with. When we get born again, yes, we're saved right then, but then this attitude that I know everything and I can do everything, God's got to get rid of that. You ain't got to say it so loud. Woo! And I know Miss Beverly, when she looks at me, she sees the exception to that because I was never like that, right? Hush. Hush, hush, hush. Hush, hush. Listen, folks. It's not just the men. Ladies, y'all like to be the boss of us too. Because y'all know everything too. Y'all know how us men need to behave. Do you know, When Beverly and I were dating, she never complained about the way I dressed. But bless God, when we got married, you're not wearing that. I've been wearing this. You're not wearing it now. And so we go through this deal. And it's the same way with our spirit, that choice making, that decision making, that thinking inside of us that we've known our entire lives, and now all of a sudden one day God's Holy Spirit gets a hold of us and we're convicted and I've been doing it this way, and yeah, but you don't need to do it that way anymore. But I've had this attitude, but you don't need to have that attitude anymore. But and the Holy Spirit is teaching us. He is redeeming us. He is fulfilling His redemptive purpose. Only He can do. We cannot do it ourselves. You can read all the books, and I'm not against reading. You can read all the books that you want to have, but they will not change you. It is the Holy Spirit of God working inside of us, regenerating, birthing that new idea, that new way of doing life, that power of God Almighty working inside of us, shifting our way of thinking, helping me to understand It doesn't hurt to read the instructions. It doesn't hurt to read the instructions. You know, there, you say, Brother Rick, I don't like to read. I'm going to tell you something. I'm gearing up for it. I'm getting ready. I got a message burning inside of me. Brother Ken, you're going to like it. You know, I've always wondered in the Old Testament, and I know I'm wondering right now, but just bear with me. I'm going to show you what the Word of God will do. I'm going to show you how God works through His Word. I've been reading this thing a long time. And I've read through it, not bragging, but if you're going to know what God says, you got to read it. You can't just hold it up here and hope that it'll kind of migrate, you know. That ain't going to work. You got to read it. If you're going to know what he has to say to you, if you want transformation to take place, you got to read. And there was a part in Leviticus, and I know everybody loves Leviticus. But I'm telling you, man, some of the greatest revelations I've ever gotten from God's Word got from Leviticus. You cannot understand the 70 weeks of Daniel until you understand the book of Leviticus, or at least that one section that is there. But I've always wondered, because it says in there, he talks about, you know, the priest is to take and shed the blood and then take his right finger, touch the right earlobe, and then the right thumb, and then the right big toe. And I'm like, what is up with the big toe and the right thumb and the right earlobe? Okay, what is all of that? I didn't understand. This year, reading again through the book of Leviticus, read it. This year, when I went through the book of Leviticus and got to that, oh, I'm going to preach on it. So get ready. We're going to go one day to the book of Leviticus here in the coming weeks. We're going to go there, and man, I'm telling you, it's shouting ground. You may think, how am I going to get excited about a big toe? A right big toe. Not just any big toe, but the right big toe. I'm telling you, folks, it's wonderful. But you know what? God had to transform my way of thinking, because I kept thinking about a natural right big toe and a natural right thumb and a natural right earlobe. And that ain't it at all. It's got to be the Holy Spirit bringing the Word of God to life. So when we read it, we're just like, oh, God, your Word is sweeter than honey, and it brings strength to my soul. Why? That's the Holy Spirit taking the Word of God and doing a work in us that we cannot do ourselves. God has to do it. He has to. But he's not going to until I say yes to him. You see, remember last week we talked about the Spirit of God, the Ruach of God, the Hebrew word Ruach. It is translated throughout the Old Testament as breath, wind, and spirit. In John chapter 14, verse number 16, Jesus says, and I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. You see, Jesus has been telling them. He's been telling them. I'm leaving. You can't come. I'm leaving. You can't come. I'm going to die, but I'll be raised to life again. And he's been telling them, and they're worried, and they're fraught, and they're just, where are you going? Why can't we come? And all this stuff. And he's telling them here, he said, I'm praying to the Father, and he's going to give you, I've been helping you all this time. You got in a jam, and I helped you. You're going to get in another jam, and I'm not going to be here in person, but I got a helper coming. Hang on. He said, I'm going to pray, and the Father's going to give you another helper, that he, the helper, may abide with you forever, the Spirit of truth. whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. Jesus said, I'm going to pray. Jesus said, I am going to pray. Can I tell you something? He's still praying for you. He didn't give up on you. He's still praying for you. He said, I'm going to pray to the Father to give you another helper. Why? How many days have you needed help from God? Every day. I know we don't realize it. It goes back to, we're walking with God now. Okay, Lord, I got this. I got this. And I'm going to just, yeah, I got this. And I'm just going to boogie on out here. And I'm going to show everybody how to live for Jesus. And it ain't long. We're like Peter. We done got our eyes off Jesus and we're sinking down. Lord, help me. Help me. Help me. I done got myself in a mess. Done let my alligator mouth overload my hummingbird backside. Smarted off. Father has given us another helper. He's given us a helper. And he, the helper, he is the third person of the Trinity. He is the Holy Spirit. He is, listen, man, if you can't get excited about this, I just don't know. Listen to me. The same Holy Spirit that you go back to Genesis chapter 1 that we talked about last week, that same Holy Spirit that was waiting in the lungs of God. And when God spoke, man, the stars, the earth, all this stuff just boom, and there it was. God's creating power through his voice, that spirit that came out of him, that ruach, that breath, that spirit, that wind that came out of him. That helper is now made available to us. Power, power, power. But he's also the spirit of truth. What is he going to do? He's going to abide. He's going to live in the house. Paul, I believe it's the Apostle Paul, he said, know you not that your body is the temple, the house of God's Holy Spirit. And Jesus said, he's going to abide with you. He's going to live with you. Listen, at 12:05, when we walk out and we lock these doors, he's not locked up in here. If you're a believer, he's with you. When you face trials, he's with you. When you face temptation, he's with you. When you're struggling, he's with you. When you're under attack, verbally, physically, spiritually, financially, anytime you are doing life, as long as you are living as a believer in Jesus Christ, he is with you. Jesus said it. He said he's going to abide with you forever. And he's the spirit of truth. Can I just put something out here right now? Truth never changes. I know the culture that we're in doesn't believe that. I can prove it. You go back and you read the history books. You read the psychology books. And the ideas that they had back then, they've rejected. And they're putting forth a new truth. Truth doesn't change. I'm sorry, it does not change. And the spirit of truth teaches us the real truth because it's never going to change. He's not going to change. So that's why do not let culture interpret the word of God. They don't know him, and they're not going to be successful at it. So, but he also says he dwells with you. Jesus says he dwells with you. Now let's look at John chapter 16, verse number 8 and following. And when he has come, he will convict the world. Now this is the same conversation. We've just jumped ahead in time just a little bit. The same conversation where he says, I'm going to pray. The Father's going to give you a helper. Just drop down a little while. And in that same activity, when he has come, when he, the Holy Spirit, has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged. Let me help you with that. Conviction. You see, he's the truth. We need to be convicted when we're not doing the truth, when we're believing a lie, when we're believing that the devil tells us that we're okay. I could tell you story after story after story of people being in church for years, 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 only to come to the realization that they're not saved. Being in church does not save us. Allowing God's Holy Spirit to do a work in us, that saves us. So he's convicting us of sin. Jesus says he's convicting the world of righteousness. I believe we all came to the place one day to where we realized that Jesus really was the Son of God. And he really did die for our sins. And he really was buried, and he rose again on the third day, and he has ascended to the right hand of the Father, and he's seated there praying for us. Righteousness. And when we realize our righteousness ain't going to get it, but his righteousness is, he convicts the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. One day, we're not here to redeem this world. This world, pardon me, and I hope this doesn't offend you, but an old saying that I grew up here, world's going to hell in a handbasket. You're not going to make it into heaven by being good. We're not going to make it into heaven by just hoping so. We're going to make it into heaven because we have received Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we have been born again by the work of the Holy Spirit. It has to take place. Judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. The wrath of God, listen, the wrath of God is going to be poured out on this earth one day. You can crawl in a hole all you want to. As a matter of fact, John talks about those who, in the book of Revelation, when the judgment of God, when the wrath of God is being poured out one day, these people that didn't believe the Word, didn't believe in Jesus, didn't hold on to His Word and faith in Jesus Christ, what they're going to be doing is looking for a hole. And they're going to be crying out for the rocks, the boulders, the mountains. Fall on us. Hide us. But there ain't no hiding. There ain't no hiding. God's judgment is coming. Jesus says he will be in you. He's going to be in you. Not just with you. He's with us. I believe for me, for you, for all of us, that we had somebody praying for us. I know my mom prayed for me, and come to find out, generations past was praying for the generations that were in the future, for them to serve God and love God and just be a part of the church. He was with us. I know it's going to shock some of you. When I was in the bar, you know who else was there? But even when I was in the bar, I felt conviction. But I knew. I'd been raised better than that. When I was drinking, I knew. And I've told you before, God don't let me die. I'll bust hell wide open. because I knew he was with me. But there had to come a day when he needed to be in me. See, he's convicted me of sin, righteousness, what I need to be doing, what I shouldn't be doing, what I need to be doing. And if I don't do something right by accepting Jesus Christ, the judgment. Sin, righteousness, and judgment. He's with me, but he needs to be in me. And then shortly afterwards, when Jesus said that, he was crucified and buried. But then came the third day. Not the music group. Love them, but came the third day. The first day of the week, Sunday. And something happened on Sunday that year. John chapter 20. Then the same day at evening, talking about the first day, being the first day of the week, that resurrection Sunday morning, when the doors where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad. They were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." They were in fear. Go back and read it. They were in fear, and he brought them peace and gladness. They were in fear. He brought them peace and gladness. They didn't know what to do. They didn't realize their purpose. Jesus gave them purpose. "As the Father has sent me, I'm sending you." And I want you to notice, folks, he breathed on them. Come on. He breathed on them. Think about who Jesus is. What does the Word of God identify Jesus as? Emmanuel, God with us. So go back to Genesis chapter 1 when God breathed and he spoke. Did anything happen? Do you think when Jesus spoke and breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit," some theologians said, well, he was just making a prophetic word that was going to happen on the day of Pentecost. I don't think so. I believe it was at that moment that the regeneration part began. Up until that moment, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Noah, none of the Old Testament saints had this experience. But these new believers, right after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and he has already ascended to the Father, made the sacrifice, he has come back to the earth to show himself alive. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people have seen him before he ascends after about 40 days. So a lot of people saw him, and he's breathing. And just like that first breath in Genesis chapter 1 that went out and everything was created, that spirit, that his spirit came on that day, he said, "I'm going to be in you now." He's going to be in you. He was with us, but now he's in us. Why? Because we have been born again, a work of God's Holy Spirit. He will be in you. You see, Revelation chapter 3, verse number 19. "As many as I love," Jesus is speaking here, watch this. "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten." In other words, I'm going to tell you you're wrong, and I'm going to help you to know how to do it right. "As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him, dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I have overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Jesus says, I love you. And because I love you, I'm going to correct you. Is that not foreign? Does that not go against the teaching of our culture today? Oh, if you love me, I can do what I want. I'm sorry. Not true. Remember, we got to go back. God created us. He designed us. He made us to worship him, not worship ourselves. He made us to worship him, not worship the world. God has got a design for our body. I don't get to decide. I don't get to decide if I'm male or female. Just clear that up. I don't have a choice in that. God made me what he wanted me to be. And I can receive it or I can reject it. Folks, can I tell you something? He says, I love you and I'm going to correct you. There's a lot of ideas that I used to have that I had to get rid of. I had to let go because it didn't line up with God's word. And if I want to line my life up with God's word, Jesus said, I'm standing outside. He's not forced his way in. I'm outside, but I want in. I'm knocking at the door. You go to somebody's house. Now, you may bust up in there. I'm not, because we live in the South. Bunch of rednecks. I just thought I'd tell you. 90% of them's armed and dangerous. I'm not going to just bust up in somebody's house. Jesus is not just going to bust up inside your heart without us opening the door. I wished he would, but he's not. He says, I'm knocking. He said, if you open the door, I'll come in. He comes in, listen, by invitation. Open the door. Come on in, Lord. Come on in. Yes, I'm ashamed. For those of you that keep house, anybody ever showed up at your house when it wasn't presentable? Oh, makes you nervous, don't it? Get a phone call or a text like 2 minutes before they get there. I'm coming down the driveway. Oh, Lord, clean up, clean up. God, cover up, put all that stuff up, clean up. You're ashamed of the mess. When Jesus comes in, it's okay. He saw it before you ever got in a mess. I'm just saying. He knew I was a mess before he ever got me. But when he knocks on the door, open it up. Come on in, Lord. Welcome to the mess. Come on in. I know, but I am convinced of this. You love me. Yeah, you're going to bring correction, but you'll do it because you love me, not because you hate me. You're going to help me to think right, to do right, to get control of this little member right here. All of that stuff that is out of control in my life, you're going to bring it under control. And he says, be zealous and repent. Be excited that we get the opportunity to repent, to turn away from the bad stuff and turn to the good stuff, to turn away from the lies and turn to the truth, to turn away from all that the enemy has said that we are not and turn to the one that says we are. And he can make it so because he's God. You see, he's outside of the rebellious heart, but he's convicting and knocking, and he wants in. He said, if anyone hears my voice, if anyone hears my voice, John 6:44 says, no one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. I don't know how it can be any more clear. No one can come to me unless the Father, the same Father who was going to send the Holy Spirit, who did send the Holy Spirit, draws. If somebody is not feeling convicted of their sins and they're just like, oh, I'm going to go up there and I'm going to join the church and I'm going to do all this kind of stuff just because, hey, I like these people. They're fun to hang out with. They're a hoot. They're crazy. I like hanging out with them. And you're welcome to hang out with them. And I confess, half of them are crazy. I won't tell you which half they are. But here's the deal. We cannot be born again at our own whim or desire. It has got to be God the Father dealing with us through the Holy Spirit. I can remember, I've told you the stories. Sitting on a pew, just like you're doing. But I had my hands, this was them old wooden pews. I had my fingers locked. The Holy Spirit was dealing with me, and I'm like, nope. But I'm praying. I'm like, God, if you really want me, if it's really you, because I didn't know. He was outside. He wasn't inside. He was outside. But he wanted in. And I'm just holding on. And I prayed. And I ain't no. And when I say I prayed, I didn't pray out loud. Didn't want nobody to know. You know how we are. I'm thinking it. It's in my heart. And I'm thinking. Back and forth. And I ain't no sooner got that thought out of my mind, I look up, and God done nailed me. Because a bunch of people was up there at the altar, and they were praying. I said, God, if you want me, you'll send somebody back here to get me. There was a lady from our youth group. She came, and I'm like, busted. Okay, she ain't got to say nothing. All right, I'm going. And man, when I got to that altar, he that was outside came inside. And the burden, the weight, I'm serious, it was gone. The guilt, the shame, the despair, the fear, the anxiety, all the stuff that was weighing me down all through those years, it was gone. And I came up from there, and I knew I was a new creation. The old things had passed away, and this, man, it's a brand new life. Now, why doesn't everybody want to be saved? And I remember the fire that was in me, the burning desire to tell everybody about Jesus Christ. Why? Because he that was outside was calling. And I heard his voice. And he was knocking at the door. And I said, come on in. Come on in. You see, it's up to the individual to open the door. And when we open the door, he comes in. And he will be in you. Isn't that wonderful? Hallelujah. Revelation 3:21, we'll close with this. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. We become overcomers when we open the door and let him come in. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, not of works, lest anyone should boast. It is a work of God's Holy Spirit. It is a work of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all working together just to bring us into the kingdom of heaven. We are saved by grace through faith, and we are also, number two, we are washed in the blood. I believe it's in the book of Exodus, and I love this illustration. If you don't read the Old Testament, man, you're missing out. You're going to see some weird things, but it's some exciting things too. And we've talked about this before, about how that when the children of Israel, they were in bondage, and God sent a guy named Moses. He was a type of Savior, a type of Redeemer. And when he came to town, and million plus people are in slavery, and long story short, God wanted to set them free, just like he wants to set us free. So God, through all his workings there with the Pharaoh and everything, he said, take a lamb and sacrifice that lamb, kill that lamb, and take the blood and you put it on the doorpost and on the overhead. When he's outside and he wants to come inside, he's not coming in empty-handed, church. The Holy Spirit is not coming in empty-handed. The door of our heart, as he steps in, the blood that washes away every sin stain. His blood is sufficient. His grace is enough. His blood is powerful. It is the blood of God shed for our sins. And when he comes in, when I open the door and he comes in, the blood, that's all it took to protect them from the judgment. And it also got them out of bondage and got them to the other side. Why? Because they were washed in the blood. And we, by the power of God's Holy Spirit, are born again to live by the power of God's Holy Spirit. Not by our intelligence, not by our knowledge, our wisdom, not by our own doings, but we are given the power of God's Holy Spirit inside of us to birth us into the kingdom of God, to set us free from the bondages. And I'm not saying it happens overnight. For some of you, it's, man, the speed of light, your life was transformed. It took me a while. Still working on it. God's still working on me. Didn't we sing that song when we were children? He's still working on me to make me what I ought to be. He made the sun and the moon and the stars and all this, and I can't remember all the song. Miss Gail can probably tell us. But church, I'm telling you, God is spirit. And if you're going to worship him, and he's compelling us to worship him, it's got to be in the spirit. If you're saved, you're on your way. You know, God's working on you. He's setting you free. He's changing your heart and your mind and all kind of stuff. But if you're not saved, you can be. You can be. That's the good news. That's the gospel. If God, the Holy Spirit, the Father, is saying today, don't put him off. Don't put him off. And I'm going to make it as easy as I possibly know how. I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to invite you to pray. I can't do it for you, okay? I can kind of guide you in what to say, because there is really a method in the sense that Jesus, we just read it, we have to repent. We have to repent. In order for you to repent, you got to know that, hey, this that I've been doing, and I'm not going to go down the list naming them, because if I miss yours, you'll think you're all right. But if God is convicting you of sin, that means I got something I got to repent of, get away from, get freedom from. He can help you. You cannot do it yourself. Don't wait. Don't listen to the lie of the enemy and say, when you get it under control, then you can give your life to Jesus Christ. It will never happen. Just listen. Open up the door to your ugly, messy house, heart, and say, here it is. Here it is. Come on in. I can't straighten it out. I can't fix it. I need God. So if God's Holy Spirit is dealing with you today, and I believe He is, because folks, we're here for a reason. We're not here by mistake. We're not here by happenstance. I believe God is dealing with some folks here today. And so let's bow our heads. Eyes are closed. Nobody looking around. As I said, there really is kind of a method to this. It's not the words that we speak. It's the attitude of the heart. Lord Jesus, I acknowledge my sins. My choices have been wrong. My attitude has been wrong. The things that I have chosen in this life have been wrong. It brought me a sense of joy for a little while, but then I feel guilt, I feel pain. I don't feel like I ought to feel, and I know that. So Lord, I acknowledge that my heart, my life is a mess. And Jesus, I believe that when you died on that cross, when you died, you paid my sin debt. And Lord, when you were raised on the third day, you came out of that grave so that I could live. I don't have to die. I can live. And you have given your Holy Spirit, and you're knocking on my heart's door today. And Lord, I believe that you are the Son of God, and everything in God's Word that proclaims you to be the Lord, the Savior, the Messiah, the Redeemer. Lord, I believe all of that. And I may not understand everything, but Lord, I believe. I'm going to put all of my hope in you. I'm going to put everything in you, in your hands. I'm committing my life to you right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, I surrender to you, and I invite you to come into my heart. I open the door to my heart, and Lord, come on in. And from this day forward, I confess that Jesus is Lord of my life, and that you love me, and that you have saved me, and that you have written my name in the Lamb's Book of Life. And I am now adopted. I am part of the kingdom of heaven. I am saved. I am redeemed. I am on my way. And Lord, I give you praise and glory. And I thank you for saving me. And Lord, I also realize there may be other things in my life that as we go, you're going to deal with. And Lord, I receive it with thanksgiving. And I thank you. Doesn't mean that I'm not saved if I do something wrong. And you're not giving me permission to go out and live loosely and live like the devil. God, you have birthed me by your Holy Spirit into the kingdom. And now I'm not my own anymore. I belong to you. So Lord, teach me day by day to do your will. To think better thoughts. To have better habits, to make better choices. Help me every single day. And Lord, I thank you. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for redeeming me. by your blood and by your spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said amen and amen. If you prayed that prayer and meant it in your heart, folks, it is crucial. We have to confess before God and before people that Jesus Christ is Lord of our lives. So one of the ways that I want to make it easy for you is you take that connection card that was in your bulletin. If you don't have one, there's some more out here on the table. You fill out your name, all that stuff, and contact information. But right here, my decision today, I am committing my life to Christ. I'm renewing my commitment to Christ. I want to be baptized, or I would like to talk with a ministry team member. Any of those, or all of those, doesn't matter. Fill that out. Let us know if you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today. And then we can get you to the waters of baptism. We can make it public. We can help you. I don't know how we can make it any easier. So please, church, know that we are born of His Spirit, as the song says, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. And we are children of the Most High God. Amen. Amen. I love you. Appreciate you. Pray God's richest blessings upon you. And if you have a prayer need, you can also write that on the bottom of the card. Drop it in the bucket on the way out. If you have an offering, tithes and offerings, we'll receive those as you exit. Pine Grove, God bless you. Don't forget Brother Lamar sharing his testimony tonight. I want to invite everybody to come and hear that. It's going to be good. Got a powerful testimony. God bless you. Go in peace. Amen.
The earth that still shakes at the mention. Yes, it does. I got good news for the poor.